Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming to this next session. So this is the very first lecture sponsored by the Journal of Clinical Urology, and it gives me enormous pleasure to introduce the speaker, Mr. Justin Vale, who many of you will appreciate launched the journal, as it was then, as the British Journal of Medical and Surgical Urology, way back in May 2008. From there, the journal has gone from strength to strength, largely because of Justin's efforts in the early days. Justin is the current deputy director, or medical director of Imperial College, and has been instrumental in setting up the Hamlin Centre for Robotic Surgery at Imperial. He's going to spend the next half an hour giving the talk, which is entitled From Bed to Benchside. And I hope that you very much enjoy it. Justin, thank you.
Thank you very much, Ian, and thank you very much for giving me this fantastic pleasure and even greater privilege to deliver the inaugural JCU lecture. When I first came out with the title for this talk, I was worried that it would be corrected from bench to bedside, which is how we normally talk about translational research. But I think I wanted to make the point that the best types of collaboration come from defining a clinical problem to our research scientists and the people that we can work with, and then getting them to help us come up with a solution. So we're very blessed at Imperial College for having a fantastic department of biomedical engineering and computer science, and I'm very grateful for their input and collaboration that's contributed to this work. Now, in 1930, Berkeley Moynihan, who's the first Lord Moynihan, came out with this fantastic quote, "We can surely never hope to see the craft of surgery made more perfect than it is today. We are at the end of a chapter." So here we are many, many years later, approximately 85 years later, and surgery has changed out of all recognition. So at that stage, obviously, surgery was all open surgery, with presumably very high mortality rates. We then moved through the phase of laparoscopic surgery, and of course we now have the further advent of robotic surgery. But with all of these initiatives, there's been an increasing sensory distance between the surgeon and the patient. And people love to talk about the concept of haptics, or the ability to palpate things. So when robotics, and indeed to some extent laparoscopy, first came out, people said that one of the problems is you could no longer feel the tissues. And we all know what they mean. We all glean things in medicine all the time from how things feel. So digital rectal examination is a good example. When you do an open partial nephrectomy, you'll sometimes try and define the extent of the tumor by touch. And one of the great problems with robotics is trying to recreate haptics. And there's been a lot of interest in how you can do that, but so far it's been to some extent, or to a large extent, unattainable, because to create haptic feedback mechanisms, you need refresh rates of 1 kHz, which is extremely difficult to achieve. So it may be that we need to look at alternative avenues for improving the sensory environment for surgeons, perhaps using image augmentation, which you can do with much more simplicity in terms of the refresh rates and computational skills required. So when we went to the collaborators in Imperial, what we were interested more was in augmented reality as a way of enhancing the robotic field. And augmented reality, as compared to virtual reality, of course, is a direct or indirect view of the physical real-world environment, augmented by computer-generated sensory inputs such as sound, video, or graphics. And of course, we're all familiar with augmented reality in all sorts of situations. So it's prevalent in the classroom. There's that slide on the other side, on the right, showing the looking at nail. This isn't one of my own slides, I hasten to add. I've never seen one of these machines in my life. But looking at different nail varnish colors by putting your hands in a machine. There's the Google car system there, lighting up the road. And then, of course, in everyday lives, looking at things online. So in 2005 or 6, when we had established our robotic prostatectomy program, we were interested in how we might use augmented reality to enhance robotic surgery, because the console provides an ideal platform. And we were one of the few research centers worldwide who had the opportunity to play with the inside of the Da Vinci robot. If you take your Da Vinci to pieces and then put it back together again, Intuitive will not cover its maintenance anymore. But we were lucky enough at that time to have a research platform. So we did some very early work in the prostate, but it was, of course, not a very good model to choose, partly because identifying nerves, which are shown there in yellow, was extremely rudimentary and extremely difficult to do. So it was based largely on a representation of where they probably ran. And secondly, of course, that time was really the advent of multiparametric MRI scans. So even if we could localize the nerves well preoperatively, we couldn't very easily localize the tumor. But as we developed a robotic partial program, the value of this technology immediately became clear. And that's our first 100 cases done using an augmented reality platform. And if you're doing a robotic partial nephrectomy on a tumor like that, it's pretty straightforward other than that it's at the upper pole of the kidney. You can see that it's almost exclusively exophytic. You don't need to delve very deep under the surface to ensure that you remove the whole tumor. But when you start to move to central tumors and largely endophytic tumors, what you see on defatting the kidney is, of course, only the tip of the iceberg. And you're relying to some extent on understanding of the preoperative imaging or intraoperative ultrasound as you go to shape and plan your further resection. This is what I thought we'd achieve. I was perhaps naive, but this was the planned achievement. So we would take the preoperative imaging, we would perform a process of segmentation, and what segmentation actually involves is painstakingly looking at the image and coloring in multiple sections of the tumor to show the tumor in, and then create the image by putting all those segments together in the computer and creating a 3D type effect. And the hope at that time, and we often show this video to funders, was that you would be able to press a button on the Da Vinci console and immediately display where the tumor is and the full depths of it as you were operating. And you could go back to that landmark all of the time. So here would be a virtual model, perhaps used in preoperative planning. And then you could draw around where you had planned to perform your initial resection around the tumor. And then you could apply that, and it would move with the kidney in real time as you manipulated the kidney in the robotic console. It could also help with identifying vessels. However, if you need that system to identify the vena cava and the renal vein, I think you've got a problem and perhaps shouldn't be doing the surgery. Of course, there's a lot more to it than that video implies. The first part really is achieved there, which is image preparation. It's quite straightforward to segment imaging, although, as we'll see in a minute on another slide, is not entirely consistent according to your experience of doing it. The second stage is the challenge, which is how you actually register the image, because when you mobilize a kidney, it bears no relationship when you finish dividing all of its lateral attachments and superior attachments. Its position bears absolutely no relationship to where it was on the preoperative MRI scan. And then you have other factors come into play, which is image deformation. When you push it or pull on it or clamp its vessels, when you clamp the arteries, you may get a change in the size of the kidney. So where we kind of got to on thinking about it more, we'd have to have two elements to this. So the planning phase would be the use of their preoperative imaging to segment and work out in advance how you'd do the surgery and perhaps be able to project that and manually register that image on the kidney during surgery. And then we'd need a much greater accuracy of registration for at the resection phase of the surgery. So we came up with a low barrier to entry system for doing the first part, the planning phase and projecting the image onto the kidney during surgery. And I'll show you a short video of that in a moment. We initially tried to do it with a 3D mouse, but I don't know how many of you have ever used a 3D mouse, but manipulating with a 3D mouse seems to be very difficult if you're over the age of about 20. If you get very young people to do it, they adapt to it instantly. But most of us are more familiar with things like the iPad. So, I've said already that we would segment it. So there's a tumor containing a the green tumor is the kidney. The green is the kidney tumor, and the yellow is a cyst. And here's a short video showing the use of this system.
The novel iPad-based system that allows a surgeon to view 3D reconstructions of patient imaging on their iPad preoperatively and on the console and iPad intraoperatively. Historically, surgeons have viewed preoperative imaging in two-dimensional slices to aid in operative planning. This requires the surgeon to perform mental reconstruction of the patient's anatomy.
Sorry about the music.
Not only has this been shown to result in an increased cognitive load for the surgeon, but it also demonstrably decreases their ability to localize anatomical structures. Recently, software has become available that allows 3D reconstructions of patient's imaging, removing the need for mental reconstructions of a patient's anatomy. Although this leads to an improved appreciation of anatomical relationships, it still falls short of allowing the surgeon to view representations of the anatomy intraoperatively. The system we have designed has a small footprint and requires a minimum of technical know-how from the surgeon. The first step is to insert a CD into the server workstation. The interface is then iPad-based. The reconstructions can be manipulated and viewed on the iPad while also being visible in 3D within the TARPRO function of the console. The only wired connection in the system is between the console and the desktop. The iPad interface is wireless, meaning it can be controlled either by the surgeon, at the console, or an assistant. The system is designed to assist in both pre- and intraoperative planning. The preoperative planning step can be undertaken outside of the operating room, on the iPad, via the wireless network connection. During this step, the surgeon is able to save certain image orientations and transparency settings, to which he can return during the case. This orientation allows the surgeon to better plan the approach, in particular the placement of ports. Intraoperatively, the iPad is mounted on a stand attached to the Da Vinci console, allowing the surgeon easy access for image manipulation and pre-saved image states. The image visible on the iPad is also visible in 3D within the TARPRO function of the robotic console. Within this clip, you can see the surgeons manipulating the images better represent the anatomy in front of him. During the partial nephrectomies performed to date utilising the system, we have found it to be of use in three distinct operative phases. These can be simply defined as tumour localisation, definition of hilovascular anatomy, and tumour resection planning. During the first step of tumour localisation, the surgeon can utilise the system to better appreciate the location of the tumour prior to breaching Girotta's fascia, potentially reducing unnecessary tissue dissection. In the step of vessel identification, the platform gives the surgeon an improved appreciation of renal hyalur anatomy.
This is a different case.
In this clip, you can see the surgeon using the reconstructions to better his understanding of the relationship of the bifurcated renal artery with the renal vein, allowing the identification of the trunk of the renal artery with little difficulty.
So I'm going to move on at that point because, as I've said earlier, that actually I don't think this system is good enough for planning the actual or controlling the actual resection when we do it. And we'll look at the model we've developed for that in a minute. I mentioned earlier that one of the issues about segmentation is the accuracy of which it's done. And we're very lucky, once again, in that we have people who seem to specialize in segmenting, spending hours looking at imaging and segmenting them. And an average MRI will take about 15, 20 minutes, perhaps a half an hour, to segment properly. Some of it is done automatic, so it will segment the shape of the kidney for you without having to do it through a manual process. And if it's a good quality contrast study, it will do the vessels for you. But the quality of the segmentation is very important. And this was a simple study that we did looking at the ability of novices with this system, intermediates, and I gather I was an intermediate when it came to this study, and experts, people who segment images a lot. And what you find is that the gold standard or the perfect segmentation would be score a 1 in this study. So the people who do it regularly are achieving 95 to 100, nearly the score 1, which would be 100% accurate segmentation. But when you go down to a novice, we're talking more values of about 85-90%. So there are issues with the quality of the segmentation according to who does it. So we decided to look at a different way of controlling resection, and we're all familiar, those of us who have done laparoscopic surgery, with the use of an intraoperative ultrasound scan, as you can see here.
I'm going to lift up on this. I'm going to grab that. And now, this would be so much harder to do if I didn't have the robot. So there's tumor, no tumor.
So the issue with the current systems is that you can do that, and you can see where the tumor is, and you can mark it with your diathermy machine, but you can't, as it were, create an image that you can then manually register. So what we've tried to do using ultrasound is to create a simple overlay system where we actually generate an accurate image of the tumor at the time in relationship to the surface of the kidney. And we've done it by using this checkerboard pattern, which you can see on the ultrasound probe there. And as the ultrasound moves, the camera is looking at its movement, or the stereo camera is tracking its movement and then plotting its coordinates, effectively creating an image of the kidney as it goes, which can then be manipulated and fixed. And this is just some of the physics of it. There are very complex algorithms that the engineers have developed for this, which I don't begin to understand, but we'll see a brief video in a minute showing the system in use. And the beauty of it is that one camera creates the segmented image effectively, and the other one creates a surface structure, so you can superimpose the two automatically. And this is its use in a phantom kidney. Obviously, in real life, the tumors are slightly less immediately visible, but you can see how the system works. It creates a series of segments effectively, and then puts them all together to create a manipulable image. And this is what we hope to achieve, which is effectively the ability to see the top of the tumor, the surface of the kidney, and then, as it were, the rest of the iceberg under the surface. Here's a video just showing this in use.
While the use of preoperative imaging for minimally invasive surgical guidance has been successfully translated into the operating theatre, many of the problems associated with the reduced sensory experience remain. In the context of robotic partial nephrectomy procedures and using simple manual registration, this approach works well as a roadmap, allowing the surgeon to visualize the anatomically variable renal arteries and veins prior to clamping and to identify the overall location of the tumor, especially when the kidney is covered in thick layers of perinephric fat. However, during tumor resection, a complementary intraoperative imaging phase is required, accurate enough to make optimal nephron-sparing dissections possible, yet able to account for tissue deformation, while not inhibiting the surgeon's operating technique. This study assesses the feasibility of a novel method for fusing dense stereo scene reconstructions with intracorporeal freehand 3D ultrasound segmentations. The geometrical relationship between surface and subsurface structures is captured simultaneously, such that the resulting models can be appreciated from arbitrary viewpoints during resection. The idea of rendering photogrammetrically reconstructed scenes from virtual camera positions is certainly not new. In 2003, the technique was put to good use by the special effects industry. In this application, the surface of the kidney is captured using a semi-global dense stereo reconstruction algorithm combined with texture mapping. An optically tracked pickup ultrasound probe is swept across the tissue surface with robotic Cadier forceps in order to build up a three-dimensional volume from separate 2D slices. The key point is that both reconstructions take place in the same coordinate system and are therefore automatically registered. In this study, porcine kidneys were injected with an agar mixture to form completely endophytic phantom lesions. The subsurface structure is either rendered volumetrically or segmented and visualized as a surface mesh. Its relationship to the tissue surface is best appreciated with alpha blending or through static windows in the surface texture. At the console, the combined results will be manipulated with the gesture interface and viewed in stereo. Although ultrasound probe calibration can be performed to sub-millimeter levels of accuracy, further experiments are planned to quantify the method's overall effect on resection quality.
So far with this work, what we've developed is a dual modality image guidance system developed around existing readily available technology, although, as I've said, one is used in planning and the other can be used at the time of resection. There's been a lot of interest, though, in whether or not augmented reality and these types of visual overlays affect our ability to see other things in the operative field. And there's this term used, inattention blindness, the failure to perceive an unexpected object when attention is focused on another object or task. And it's been quite well documented in the military, in the aviation industry, that things can happen if, well, they're so focused on what they're seeing, on their overlay and in their display, that they miss other things going on. I'm going to show you a very brief video clip in which I want you to look at all the players wearing white T-shirts passing the basketball and count how many times they pass it to each other.
Players wearing white pass the basketball.
How many passes of the basketball did you see? Anyone? 15? Okay. How many of you saw the gorilla? Oh, good. Not everyone, though. And when they did this study with a group of volunteers, and this isn't from our research, this is in the literature, they found that only 47% of people actually missed the gorilla. They were so busy counting the basketballs that even though it was right in the center of their attention, they missed what was going on. And that was one of the concerns with these augmented reality platforms in surgery. So we did a very simple study where we randomized a large number of volunteers, approximately 80, into two groups. And one of them were given a high cognitive load while they had the virtual reality overload. And the other group were given a low cognitive load, the point being that when you're counting the basketball, you're not actually watching everything else that's happening, so you have a cognitive load. But if you're not counting them, you would obviously see the gorilla coming in. So we had 80 people randomized, 40 to high cognitive load and 40 to no cognitive load. And we had two things in the view while they were doing this. We had a swab at the background, which you can see on those slides, there, and then a needle in the middle of the field in the center of the screen. And then within those randomized groups, we then further randomized them into having no overlay, having a solid overlay, and having a wireframe overlay. And what we found interestingly was that the overlay actually had very little impact on their perception, either in their central field of view or the peripheral field of view. So the number of people seeing the needle was about 90-95% in both the high, in both groups. Likewise, the cognitive load didn't impact on the center of their field of vision. But when you look at the swab in the periphery, there was a huge difference between the people who had a high cognitive load and a low cognitive load, but interestingly, no difference with the overlay. The other interesting thing about this study was that when we asked people if they felt that the overlay had affected their cognition and their ability to see things, they felt it had. They felt it had distracted them. But in reality, the objective data suggested it didn't make any difference in practice. There have been some other studies which contradict this, so it's an interesting area, but they had slightly different designs. So I think we're on a journey. I think we've made a lot of progress with this in the last 5 years or so. But I think we are on a journey, and I think other technology is going to help us as we go. So things we'd like to do in the future, one is to actually revisit the prostate, because with tractography scanning, one can begin to see nerves reasonably accurately and track them on MRI scans. Likewise, multiparametric MRI scans are allowing us to accurately see where the cancer is. So I think revisiting the prostate work might be useful in the future in the context of nerve sparing. Automated segmentation is something else we've been looking at. We've also been looking at whether or not, once you create these maps, whether you can actually, to some extent, automate some of the dissection. And we've done some work ex vivo using a water jet dissector. And then there are all the other things to come, such as novel imaging modalities and various biomarkers. Another area of interest we have in Imperial is the intelligent knife. So in addition to the opportunity to use augmented reality platforms, one has the opportunity potentially to extract diathermy smoke, put it straight through a mass spectrometer, and know what it is you're cutting through. We've used this in breast surgery now. We haven't yet been able to use it in laparoscopic prostate surgery, but it's a potential area of exploration. And I would argue that with these types of technologies, so the use of augmented reality, perhaps the eye knife, we can move to a place in the future where the concept of haptics is very old-fashioned. This work wouldn't be possible without a huge number of collaborators. So Philip Pratt is one of the engineers involved in this. Eric Mayer, many of you will know, is the senior lecturer. And Aradazi, a lot of the work and the collaborations that we've benefited from with this were originally set up by Aradazi. And it wouldn't be right not to mention some of our PhD students, and in particular Archie Hughes-Hallett. A lot of the renal work has been done by Archie, and Daniel Cohen, who's done a lot of prostate work previously, and our funders, particularly the NIHR and the BRC Centre. So thank you very much for your attention, and I hope that this has lived up to your expectations of an inaugural lecture. Thank you.
Justin, thank you very much. That was an amazingly stimulating and highly visual lecture, and more than lived up to the expectations, I would say. We do have a couple of minutes for any questions from the audience, if there are any burning issues out there. While people are making their way, if there are any questions, I'll just ask you one thing then, Justin. Is Lord Moynihan's quote never going to be true? Is there such a thing as a surgical ceiling, or is the sky the limit, do you think?
I think the only surgical ceiling will be when surgery is no longer necessary at all.
Ah, the Holy Grail.
You look at the cyberknife earlier on, and you look at the augmented reality technologies, and you can see a time when lots of excision of things may be rendered unnecessary by the ability to deliver very, very high dose radiotherapy in a very targeted way. But who knows?
Okay. Thank you. Well, if there are no questions from the audience, we'll draw to a close. Justin, thank you again very, very much indeed.
Thank you.